Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Welcome to one and all, and very special welcome to those of you visiting us from other parishes, as well as those who are returning to us for the winter. It's always good to see you again, and I also want to welcome those who will be participating in this Eucharist sometime tomorrow via the internet. You two are always very welcome. As we prepare to celebrate these sacred mysteries, let us be mindful of the mercy of God, which is ours in Christ. Lord Jesus, you love the whole of creation. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you overlook our sins and give us pardon. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you come into our homes and hearts to save us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Reading from the Book of Wisdom. Before the Lord, the whole universe is as a grain from a balance, or a drop of morning dew come down upon the earth. But you have mercy on all, because you can do all things, and you overlook people's sins that they may repent. For you love all things that are, and loathe nothing that you have made. For what you hated, you have not fashioned. And how could a thing remain unless you willed it, or be preserved had it not been called forth by you? But you spare all things because they are yours, O Lord and lover of souls. For your imperishable spirit is in all things. Therefore, you rebuke offenders little by little, warn them, and remind them of the sins they are committing, that they may abandon their wickedness and believe in you, O Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
the second letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians. Brothers and sisters, we always pray for you that our God may make you worthy of his calling and powerfully bring to fulfillment every good purpose and every good effort of faith. And the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you and you in him, in accord with the grace of our God and Lord Jesus Christ. We ask you, brothers and sisters, with regard to the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our assembling with him, not to be shaken out of your mind suddenly, or be alarmed either by a spirit, or by an oral statement, or by a letter allegedly from us to the effect that the day of the Lord is at hand. The word of the Lord.
So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree in order to see Jesus, who was about to pass that way. When he reached the place, Jesus looked up and said, "Zacchaeus, come down quickly, for today I must stay at your house." And he came down quickly and received him with joy. When they all saw this, they began to grumble, saying, "He has gone to stay at the house of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, "Behold, half of my possessions, Lord, I shall give to the poor, and if I have extorted anything from anyone, I shall repay it four times over." And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, but this man too is a descendant of Abraham, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save what was lost." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Today, that first reading from the Book of Wisdom is really almost a work of poetry. And what the inspired author is doing is he's comparing the enormity of God with the enormity of the universe. And so he says, before the Lord, the whole universe is as a grain from a balance, or a drop of morning dew come down upon the earth. It's quite obvious that this author has never had the opportunity to look through a James Webb space telescope, right? Because remember those pictures that came out recently of all these galaxies around us and all of these stars and billions of stars and so on? But I don't think that needs to worry us here. Because what the inspired author is really doing is he's speaking of the enormity of God's creative and redemptive love. The God who puts the world into motion through creation, as well as the redemption that occurs in history in Christ Jesus, and which continues every day. And the words love all things that are, and you loathe nothing that you have made. For what you hated, you would not have fashioned. And how could a thing remain unless you willed it, or be preserved had it not been called forth by you? You spare all things because they are yours, O Lord and lover of souls, for your imperishable spirit is in all things. And now we go to the gospel, and in walks Zacchaeus, who's loathed by many just by virtue of being a chief tax collector. The idea is that he is a sinner, and certainly not to be associated with by any pious Jew, a collaborator with the Roman occupiers because he's collecting taxes for them, and he's often cheating and asking for more than the people actually owe in taxes. And what we see is Jesus does not see him as despicable nor loathsome as the people do. And so in order to awaken within him the desire for change of heart and conversion, Jesus shows love for Zacchaeus instead of deprecation like the people are doing. As shorter people often experience, their vision is often obstructed by taller people. Anybody short here? Is it true? Anyway. And so he could not see Jesus. So it really, again, it puts him in a sort of a second class. People are separated in some way by his stature. And he had heard of Jesus and heard he was passing through the town. And he wanted to see him and to make contact with him. And so this is a man of a certain social class because he's wealthy. Whether it's ill-begotten wealth or not, he's still wealthy. And yet, he climbs up a sycamore tree as a child would do. And there, in order to see Jesus. And when Jesus looks up, he says, Zacchaeus, I must stay with you today. Come down quickly from that tree. I must stay at your house. And he speaks with this authority that he must stay at the house. And again, Jesus does not disparage Zacchaeus, but asks to be welcomed into his house. This eagerness corresponds to the great desire of Zacchaeus, the great lengths that he comes to encounter Jesus. And so he says, this day is the day. And you can just imagine Zacchaeus' joy at hearing that from the Lord, because he knows he's despised by the people, and it's the joy of being welcomed not only with respect, but also with affection by Jesus, who wants to establish a relationship, a friendship with him. In ancient times, when you invited someone into your household to offer hospitality, you were making a lifetime commitment, because rare was it. And so, in fact, Jesus does this because he does intend to establish an enduring relationship with Zacchaeus. And of course, people are scandalized by this. They need a little conversion themselves, because they're blinded to the presence of the God who loathes nothing and who loathes no one. And that's the God that they call their own, the God of the people Israel. And they don't understand that Jesus went in not to maintain the status quo, but rather to transform the situation, not to maintain it as it is. He's bringing a new covenant that will profoundly change the human situation, even among the people, before God and among people. And so Jesus' initiative becomes fruitful because it provokes within him a radical conversion. The generosity of God opens the heart of this rich man. And Zechariah manifests it, this profound capacity that he had, but was hidden by a status of responsibility and his desire for money to accumulate wealth. And so his response is, "Half my possessions, Lord, I shall give to the poor. If I have extorted anything from anyone, I shall pay it four times over." The law, the Torah, said that if you fraud someone, that you must repay 20% over. And here, Zechariah is offering 400% over. It was an extraordinarily generous response and a desire not to defraud people. So Zechariah's decision to act in this new way, the new generous way, is a decision from his heart. It's not imposed upon him. It's his response to the welcoming of the Lord and seeing him as a child of Abraham, as he will say at the end. He observes what Zechariah welcomed, the generosity of Jesus into his heart, and he was transformed. And Jesus observes, finally, today salvation has come to this house because this man, too, is a descendant of Abraham. He is one of us who is now walking in a new way. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save the lost. Isn't that lovely? Now, there's another twist to this, is that scholarship is divided now about, was the conversion made at the house, or had it already been made before he goes to the house? And what they're saying is that the verb, you know, here it's sort of in the future, I shall give half of what I have to the poor, and so on. And many scholars say it's in the presence. I give this month money to the poor, half my money to the poor, and that I will, should I have frauded someone, I will repay them 400%. And now I know this seems kind of dumb, but this is what they're talking about, grammar here. So one way he's converted in that experience, the other way, what he does in his response, even before he goes to the house, is he says, I give half my money, presents. If I defraud someone, I will give. Not I will, I give this much. And in a certain sense, it's defending his reputation. And that the presumption of the people was by virtue of having been a tax collector, that he was dishonest. And that he was a dishonest man, basically. And he's proclaiming that this is what he does. Now, if this is the case, who needs the repentance? The people who presumed he was a lousy lout. Just presuming that this guy, because of his profession, because of perhaps his stature. You know, there are people who are prejudiced against short people. So, I think there's a little something for all of us in terms of conversion here. If it's presuming about other people and things about them that are bad, that are not true, we have to take a look at our own lives and look at our own need for conversion. And if it's the way I just described it, and come to know that either way, that Jesus has come into the world to seek the lost and to find the lost. And there was one other thing I wanted to say here too, is that as believers called to glorify Jesus in our lives, that's St. Paul's letter in the second reading today, believers called to glorify Jesus in our own lives, we should not be obstacles to the love that seeks the lost and extend it to the lost. That is not to be blinded, to be able to see that God loathes no one and nothing. That's two for the price of one. lives of people of faith, we profess that which lies at the center of our lives, saying, I believe
in one God, Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us sin and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit, was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became human. For our sake, he was crucified and crucified. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord of the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
God loves all life because God created all life. So we are confident God hears us as we pray on behalf of the lives of all.
For the church, that Christ find us eager and ready for him on the day of his coming, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those seeking salvation in wealth and material things, that they find it rather in Jesus, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an end to war, terrorism, and conflicts caused by religious beliefs and differences, that all people find a way to love their neighbor, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have dedicated their lives to serving those without material wealth, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are not able to be here due to their health or to disabilities, and for those who bring the Eucharist to them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who gather at this table and for all who cannot take part, that they find refreshment and fulfillment in Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our beloved dead, that they may receive the reward of eternal life, especially Delia Trainer, Sharon Grant, Juan Delaney, and Father Seraphim Connolly, may they be admitted to the company of saints, and may those who mourn their loss be comforted. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the needs we hold close to our hearts and all our intentions, spoken and unspoken, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of life and love, you free us from fear and stir up our hearts to hope in you. Make us worthy of the holiness to which you call us. Hear our pleas and all our cries to you through your Son, our teacher, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. As we prepare the table of the Lord, let us sing together number 506 in the music issue, Center of My Life.
Thank you.
acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the whole of his holy church.
May these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, become for you a pure oblation, and for us a holy outpouring of your mercy, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For we know it belongs to your boundless glory that you came to the aid of mortal beings with your divinity, and even fashioned for us a remedy out of mortality itself, that the cause of our downfall might become the means of our salvation through Jesus the Christ. Through him, the host of angels adores your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim. Giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, on that same evening, he took the chalice of blessing in his hands, confessing your mercy, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Accept us also together with your Son, and in this saving banquet, graciously to endow us with his very Spirit, who takes away everything that estranges us from he an instrument of your peace among all people. And may he keep us in communion with Francis our Pope and John our Bishop and all the bishops and your entire people. Just as you have gathered us now at the table of your Son, so also bring us together with the glorious Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your blessed apostles, with Saint Francis and all the saints, with our sisters and brothers and those of every race and tongue who have died in your friendship. Bring us to share with them the unending banquet of unity in a new heaven and a new earth, where the fullness of your peace will shine forth in Christ Jesus our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
With trust and confidence, we now pray to our Heavenly Father as Jesus has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let's offer to those near us some gesture of our peace in Christ.
Myself entirely to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
announcements today. Trunk or Treat is Sunday, October 30th. That's tomorrow from 3 to 5 p.m. There will be a hayride, games, and many fun activities for all ages. All Souls envelopes for November's Novena Masses are located in the narthex of the church. Masses for All Saints, a holy day of obligation, are on November 1st at 8:30, regular Mass, and then 1 at noon. Also on November 1st, the Women's Guild meeting will take place at 1 o'clock. There will be a memorial Mass for Father Seraphim on November 2nd at 11 o'clock. There's an ordination of Brother Patrick Corrigan, who's one of our friars. He preached all the Masses last week. If you were here, that's him. Anyway, he's going to be ordained here in this church at 10 o'clock on November 5th, that's Saturday. We are providing Thanksgiving and Christmas baskets this year to needy families. Please see the bulletin for specific information on donating items. Let us pray. May the working of your power, O Lord, increase in us, we pray, so that renewed by these heavenly sacraments, we may be prepared by your gift for receiving what they promise, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless us and keep us this night and bring us to our beds in peace, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Let us walk this week in the light and in the love of Christ Jesus.
Let us rejoice together singing number 555 in the music issue, All the